continue. Now we look at the finite volume discretization of these two-dimensional hyperbolic scalar conservation laws, like the simplified Burgers equation. With the cell average, similar way as we did in 1D, quality of U hat of T. And then that is defined as 1, now this notation for the area of the control volume, and we integrate over omega, and we integrate over x, y, the conserved variable, over the control volume, so the volume digit. Where in here the omega denotes the volume of our control volume, and we are in 2D, imagine the 3D is just constant, 1 meter in the z direction, for example. So that is then the area of the control volume. So we use control volume for any dimension. So with that definition of the cell average, the integral form of the 2D scalar conservation law 1 can be expressed as and that is then 6. So you see here that there was an integral of the time derivative appearing in the integral form number 1, and we can then use this definition here of the cell average, and if we take the time derivative of, if you multiply by omega, take the time derivative of that, get the time derivative of this, we can draw it inside, and then we see that this, what we get, is then the same as taking the area of the control volume times the time derivative of the cell average, plus the flux over the boundary. So that is unchanged. The flux over the boundary is unchanged. So that is a surface integral where we integrate over the flux vector f of u, which has an x and y component, and we take the inner product with the outer unit norm of n. That will be then a surface integral. In our case, for the 2D case, it will be a line integral, which we'll look at that in a minute. And on the right hand side, we have a volume integral, and here an area integral. So this is then the source term S of U and the volume integral. So we then have just introduced the cell average here. And the reason is, in the finite volume method, we do approximations of the cell averages, as we have done for the 1D case, and we do that also in 2D. So that will be our task, to do to give approximations for the cell averages. And when we do that, you can already imagine now the problem that we will have. Our problem will be, like in 1D, to determine these fluxes. Because for the fluxes, we would have to know the exact solution on the boundary to do this integration with properly. So we would have to know f of u, or u itself, on the boundary of the domain. And that we usually don't know, so there we have to do approximations to replace the physical fluxes by numerical ones. We make here a simplification in the sense that we consider the finite volume method for the Cartesian case. Later on, we shall see the generalization to general grids, but we focus here in the beginning on Cartesian grids. So that is the simplest what we can imagine. And a Cartesian grid that is one that you have already here from the course notes, from lecture notes. We look at it now in more detail here. So we have then now the x and y directions. So that is, and we imagine that we have some domain that is rectangular. Let's assume we have something like that. So that would be our domain. Yeah. And we then divide that domain in equal distances both in x and y. So let us try to do that here. So we have x. Oh, they should look equal, but it's difficult for me to do that. Okay, so let's assume that they are equal. And then we do the same, something similar in the y direction. We also use equidistant, the grid, the distribution in the y direction. And so what we have, for example, if we are here, then this interval here, that would be delta x. We assume that it is constant. And the grid space in here, that would be delta y. We assume that they are equal. They need not to be the same, but in the x direction, we assume that the grid spacing is the same, so the delta xi, we call it, is delta x, and the grid spacing in the y direction, for the delta yj, is constant delta y. And now we have to indicate where we are. So we have to give the cells some names or some, we have to identify them. And the way we do it is we introduce indices. For example, we say if we want to identify this control volume here, this particular one, then we can identify that by its midpoint, which would be the xi, and here on this side would be the yj. And then we can identify this grid point, or this cell, actually, this cell, that is what we interest by ij. So it is the, if you think of the cell, so this is, if we start from the left, it would be the cell number, so that would be the cell number 1, 2, and so on, that would be the cell number, I can move that, that would be the cell number I, and this would be, I call it the cell number ni. So we use the I index for the x direction, and we use the j index for the y direction. So this would be number 1, and so on, and then we would have here nj. So that means we have ni cells in the x direction, and we have nj cells in the y direction. So in total, we have ni times nj cells. And we identify them and then by their indices. So then we are in cell ij. We immediately know the neighbors, because the right neighbor, that cell, will be then the I plus 1j. And the left neighbor will be the I minus 1j. So, and the northern neighbor, that will be the ij plus 1, and the southern neighbor will be the ij minus 1. So once we have identified a cell by its indices, we immediately know the neighbors. So that is the nice thing with a structured, with a Cartesian grid. And they have the same size in x direction, and maybe a different one, but the same size in the y direction. So then the equation 6, the integral form for the 2D scalar conservation law, can now be formulated for this control volume or this cell ij. So that is the equation 6, representing our
be scalar conservation law for the cell control volume ij can then be written in the following form. What is the volume of the cell? Imagine the volume of the cell. Define here what's the volume of our cell. Delta x times delta y. So you have assumed now that we have unity in the z direction, so then we can simply say that the volume is delta x times delta y, and then we have the time derivative of the cell average, and now we mark that by the indices ij. It is still dependent on time. And then we have the fluxes, and the fluxes are then over the boundary of the control volume. That is here the eastern, western, northern, southern face. So all this is the boundary of the control volume omega ij. And there we have to integrate over the flux vector f, which depends on u. We have the inner product with the Cauchy unit normal vector, integrate over the a, and we might have a source term, which is a volume integral, in our case, including the surface integral, over the source term, s of u dv. So that will be then the exact form of the 2D scalar conservation law for a Cartesian grid set. Now we have to look in more detail on these fluxes here and write what they are. So let us try to illustrate that. So we enlarge the control volume. So that is our control volume omega I. So that is the omega I j here. And what I've indicated, that is the boundary. So the eastern boundary will be this one, and there the unit normal vector goes in the positive x direction. Remember, the coordinate system is x, y. This is the western boundary, and there the normal vector goes in the negative x direction. So what I'm indicating here is the normal vector. So that would be that the eastern, western, here we have the northern face. So that would be the northern face, then we have the normal vector, and then the southern face, the normal vector will go in this direction, will be going in the negative y direction, so that is the southern. So we have four faces, and we have for each of them, we have to then, they all together, they make up the surface integral here. So then we write down what this surface integral is. And that is then the flux over the boundary of the cell omega j. Boundary of omega I j. That we call A. And that is the integral over the boundary, which we call B omega j, of our flux vector, and of u in the product n. And we can immediately say that we are then considering line integrals because we had assumed that in the z direction, so it would be the direction out of the plane, we have just a unit length. So when we have computed this here, we just multiply by 1 meter to get this effect from the third dimension. So we just can neglect that and just concentrate on that we are in 2D. So then this will be line integrals that we have to consider. And so they will have then these four contributions. So this V
flux then is consisting of the following. We go from this point to this point, that is here to here. Now we introduce the notation that we have been using frequently. We call this location here, we call this the y, and that is then related to the j. So this is then the j minus 1/2, and this location here is then the y j plus 1/2. So we introduce again the half vertices. We do the same for the x direction. So here. So this was then the y j minus 1/2. So our coordinate system is x and y. And here we have then the x I minus 1/2. And here we have the x I plus 1/2. So they are the boundaries of our control volume omega ij. And then when we start with the eastern face, we see that the surface integral here, what will we get? The n will be, what is it? 1, 0. We have only a component in the x direction. So that we'll get only here the f1 of u. This is f1, f2. Scalar product with this gives f1. So then we have here the f1 of u. And we are at x I plus 1/2. We are at some point y and at some point in time. And we integrate over y. And from which point do we integrate? It's from y j minus 1/2 to y j plus 1/2. So that is the eastern contribution that we have here. If we continue our journey, we get to the northern face, then we will have an integral now from this point to this point. That is, we will have an integral from x I minus 1/2 to x I plus 1/2. So we will integrate over, let's look at it. What is the n here? Just a component in y direction, 0, 1. So the inner product then with the f gives us f2. So we'll have here then f2 of u, and u will depend on x, on which we will integrate, and it will be at y j plus 1/2. It will be at y j plus 1/2 and at some time t. And we integrate over x. So that is the flux contribution from the northern face. And then we continue, let's see. Well, we have this here, so I can take that away. The n here is in the negative y direction, negative x direction, so it is minus 1, 0. The inner product with the fn gives us then minus f1. So therefore we have here the minus. And then we have the integral, again, from here to here. So from y j minus 1/2. Y j plus 1/2, and we integrate, as we have said, over minus f1, the minus is already here, depends on u. We are now at x I minus 1/2, the left at the western face. We have y and t, and we integrate over y. And then finally, we get to the southern face. There the normal vector is 0 minus 1.
And the inner product then, Fn, gives us minus F2. So then we have the integral over minus, is already there, F2 of u, and then we will integrate over x, we will be at y j minus 1 half, and which depends on t, and we will integrate over x. And the bounds will be xi minus 1 half and xi plus 1 half. Okay, so that's it. So this here and this here, that together is then representing our flux. Here open, because it's continued here. So all these two things here that we have here. So they are then expressing our flux. We have four contributions. If we say that this contribution here, that is the contribution over the eastern face. So that is the eastern contribution. Here we have a contribution over the northern face, northern. And here we have a flux with a minus sign. That is just indicating this. That would be then the western flux, and then here we have a contribution for the southern flux. So we have these four contributions. They make up the flux of the boundary. Imagine if we had the continuity equation, this would be the mass flow. The mass flow over our control volume, eastern, northern, western, southern faces. And now we want to approximate these fluxes using the cell averages. What we have, remember we have only approximations to the cell averages in the cells. So then we do that. So the fluxes are approximated by in the same way as we did it in 1D, neighboring or adjacent to cell averages. And as an example, e.g., for example, for the uplink method, we would do it in the following way. One that we are going to use. It will be 9a. There we will look at the contribution for the flux over the eastern face. So let us look at this here. So it's an integral over f1. And what is varying is y. So how can we do that? Well, we could do it, we say we take an average of that, of f1 over this face, and multiply by delta y. This length here is delta y. So then we say we take f1 at the eastern face and multiply by delta y. And then to get the f1, that is the flux over the eastern face, we shall use the values in cell ij and in the right neighbor I plus 1j in the same way as we did in 1D. Remember, in 1D we had at the corresponding eastern face we used the values in I and or j and j plus 1. Here we use the values in I, j and I plus 1j. So first, just the same. If we use the upwind method, the general form would be that we take the flux function f1 that we are considering here,
evaluate that with the value of the cell ij, and then we take the flux, the component in x direction f1, evaluate it with the value in the eastern neighbor, which is I plus 1j. So that would be the central discretization, but we don't want to have that here when we have discontinuities, or even without the explicit Euler method would not work. So then we take here the A1, that is the component of the characteristic velocity in the x direction. We take that, and we take the absolute value, and we take it at the phase I plus 1 half j. So that is something that we have to determine. And that will be multiplied by the difference in u I plus 1 j and u I j. What we have here is, if you just forget about the j index, that's the upwind method for a 1D problem. Our flux is F1, and then this is the general upwind method. So then we have an approximation of the flux F1 over the eastern phase. And that we have to multiply by delta y. So therefore we have here the delta y. So we can approximate, or we can note that, we can also write that in a different way, that we write this as F1. So we write this as F1 of, instead of the E, we use then the index notation, I plus 1 half J. So then, sorry, delta Y. So then we would have the notation with east, with the west and so on, and this would be the index notation. For the western phase, things are then just similar. We just have to shift the index. So that is then easy. Let's do that. Let's see, let us like to have that. And we can avoid it. Let's see. So let's continue the 9b, that is the flux over the western phase, and that is then the F1 west, and then that is then our approximation on the western phase, that is multiplied by delta y, and that will be, we can obtain that when we shift the index here, when we just go to I minus 1 half. So then we would have here I minus 1, I minus 1 half, because it is then at that phase, I and I minus 1. So then we just write that in this form, which is the F1. And it is then at I minus 1 half j times delta y. So that was easy. 9c, we want to know the northern flux over the northern face. That is this one here. And so there we have to integrate in the x direction over x. And then we take, let's say, some mean value of F2 at the northern phase and multiply by delta x, that is the length of that interval. So then we would have the F2 at the northern phase times delta x. How do we do it? We do it in exactly the same way as we did for 1D. We are now in this picture here. For we are at the northern phase, we have ij and ij plus 1. And we have to approximate F2 on this northern phase. And we do it exactly the way as in 1D. That means we evaluate now the flux F2 with the value in the cell ij in the cell northern, which is ij plus 1. That would be central discretization. We don't want that. We take then the A2, and we take that at the face ij plus 1/2. So that is the northern face in the index notation. And then we take the difference in u at ij plus 1 and uij. So then we have the 1D flux approximation of F2 in just the same way as we did in 1D. Our flux is now the F2, and the direction is the y direction. So therefore the index here is in fact the same as we had in 1D. So that is F2, and we have to multiply that by delta x. So then we have it. And then we also use then the other notation, index notation for that would be that we call this F2, and it would be the ij plus 1/2 delta x. That would be then equal to what we have here. So then we have the northern one, take that away. So now we have considered the eastern, we have the western, northern, now is the southern one. So this is left, but that is again an easy one, because we can relate that to the northern one, southern one, by just considering that we have two that we have to approximate there, multiply by delta x as the mean, the southern times the length. That is then equal to the flux that we have determined by the index shifted, j index shifted. So that is then we have two by ij minus 1/2 times delta x. Again, you just go in here below the j, so j minus 1, j, j minus 1/2, j, j minus 1. So then we have everything. So then we have the flux approximations, but very important thing missing, the characteristic speeds, a1 and a2. So this one here, the characteristic speed in the x direction, and this is the characteristic speed in the y direction. We have to give them. Same way as we have done in 1D. So the A1, we start first with that. The A1, I plus 1/2 J, that is the one that we need at the eastern face. That is equal to, and if you remember, this term is sent by the shock speed in that direction, and that is the F1. And that is the F1 of ui plus 1j minus F1 of uij divided by the difference in u, ui plus 1j minus uij. And that we can only do if the u's are different. So that we can only do if the u, I, j is different from its eastern neighbor I plus 1j. If they are the same, we take the characteristic, the speed in that direction, which is the d f1 of u, I, j, du, if they are equal. You see, again, the same thing as we did in 1D. Okay. And the A2 we defined in a similar way. So now we have defined the A1 for the x direction. And now we do the same for the A2 for the y direction. In here. And that is then the following is the A2. And that is then at ij plus 1/2. Again, we take the shock speed, then define them with the F2. This is the F2 of, now we have to take the northern neighbor, which is ij plus 1 minus ft of uij divided by the difference, if the difference is not 0, that is, if uij is not equal to the northern neighbor uij plus 1. If they are equal, then we take the characteristic speed in that direction, which is then the df2 of uij with respect to u. And that is if these are equal. Uij plus 1. So they are then, you see, they are defined in just the same way as we had in 1D. So that means what we are doing here is the following. The flux is F1 are determined by essentially what we are doing here by solving the Riemann problem. And if you use the upwind method, we can solve the Riemann problem approximately. And the Riemann problem that we solve approximately for the x direction, that is for the flux F1, is the following. We assume as initial condition, so we assume it's just a problem in x and t. And then we assume that we have the u left, is then given, so we are now at this face here to the right, so here this face here. So then the left state is uij, and the right state is ui plus 1j. That is for the first order method. That is uij, and that is for x smaller than the face, that is xi plus 1 half j. And it is u right, and there we take what I just said, ui plus 1 for x greater than x I plus 1 half j. And we do that then to solve the 1D problem, time derivative of u plus the f1 of u, x derivative of u to 0. So that is now our Riemann problem here. So we have simplified that to a 1D problem. And for that, that is the solution. What we know from 1D, we have already done that for the 1D scalar conservation law. And what we are doing here for the y direction is similar. Then we take also a Riemann problem to find them at the northern face, if we look at the face j plus 1 half. Consider a problem in the y direction. So then we ignore the x direction. So then our y time t equals 0. And then we have the ul given now again by the uij. The value approximation in our cell ij. And that is for y smaller than the face, which is ij plus 1 half. And we have the u right given by the normal value, which is uij plus 1. That is for y greater than yij plus 1 half. And then we saw that for the conservation law, the one conservation law, which is then the F2 of U, and the y derivative is equal to 0. So then our Riemann problem looks like that. And that we solve approximately by the upward method. You can also use any other method, and that is our free choice. And we can simply generalize, as we did now for the upwind method, we can generalize any of the other methods that we have seen to 2D, because we apply them essentially in a one-dimensional fashion, as you see. So once, and then we take them direction by direction and use the 1D approach then in each direction. So I just note this. So instead of the upwind method, which we also could call a Rose approximate Riemann solver, that is essentially Rho. Any other method that we considered that was a chapter on the 1D scalar conservation laws, that is in chapter 5, can be used. For example, e.g., we could use Goodenough method, then we would solve these two Riemann problems that we have seen here for the x and y direction exactly. We could use the Lex Friedrichs method. Where we, instead of having these characteristic speeds entering, would have delta x divided by delta t. Or we could use, which would be better, that is what we have been doing, we could use the Rosenau method. And so on. So, Lindquist, Osher, whatever we like. So we have many options. It is just a generalization what we have from 1D to 2D. You can imagine you can go on to 3D. You would have higher dimensions. You could do that also. So, what can we do to get higher order? Well, I think we are close to the end, but just say it. We can simply use the muscle approach. We can use the muscle approach in just the same way as we did for 1D to get, instead of, for example, this here, uij and ui plus 1j, we get the extrapolated values. So the left extrapolated value at the face I plus 1 half and the right extrapolated value at the face I plus 1 half. And here we would do the same thing in the y direction. We would have the left extrapolated value at yij plus 1 half and the right extrapolated value here. And then we would use the same method. Just the same as we have in 1D. So in that way, we can easily get higher order with these methods. Okay, so tomorrow we'll continue on this, such that you can then solve the 2D indices Burgers equation simplified in the y direction as linear for exercise 7.